Greetings, I am Herbert Erpaderp. Today I'm going to build this Masterbox Mark 1 female British tank with special modification for the Gaza Strip, which I assume is the thing on the roof. Not quite sure what it does, but it does a thing, I suppose. This is, as you might guess, a World War 1 tank. I've not done much World War 1 stuff, and I've never built anything from Masterbox, but the price was right, which is to say low, so why not give it a whirl? The back of the box has a colour guide, which, as these things quite often are, is very basic. I'm sure it would make for a decent starting point though. Inside the box we find a bag of plastic, and the dreaded rubber band tracks. These are, well, they're not amazing, but they're not the worst I've seen, especially when you consider that this is not an expensive kit. Also, for this kind of tank, rubber band tracks do make sense. I just wish they didn't have that awful flash along the sides. Fortunately, the plastic is a bit better, quite a lot better actually. The detail here is pretty good, in my opinion. There's a good amount of nice rivet detail, and these old tanks did have a lot of rivets. It looks like this kit could be built as other variants of the Mark 1 because there are wheels for the rear, which aren't used on this model, as well as the roofy, framey thing that would be mounted on top, which I believe was to deflect grenades, though I'm not sure. Whatever it's for, it's not used in this kit. The parts here are pretty well molded and fairly neat. I did find one defect, though it doesn't seem to be from the molding process. And everything else is fine, though there is a little bit of flashing here and there, and there are definitely mold lines that will need to be cleaned up. Not a horrendous amount, but they are there. I was pretty pleased with these parts, considering the kit was about $12 Australian. My bits box was also pleased because there's going to be a handful of odds and ends left over after this. Decals, which you'll probably have a hard time actually seeing here, were also included with the kit. They're pretty simple. There's a series of six names that you could give this tank. I might use HMLS Archibald, because that sounds kind of funny to me. I also like that they're HMLS, being land ships. That's cool. The name landship is really entertaining to me. Unsurprisingly, instructions are also included. The first page gives some historical information in a couple of languages, and then there's a bunch of pretty simple and easy to follow diagrams. The pages are pretty big and a bit unwieldy, but I complain about that sort of thing often enough, so this time I won't. Not much anyway. The instructions do serve their purpose and that's what really matters. The last page shows us how the completed model should look and where the decals should go. It's time to start building, but first I do have a complaint. There's a big chunk missing from the corner of the lower hull part. It's kind of ugly and this wasn't caused by me. It was like this when it came out of the box. I guess it could be a lot worse, and maybe we can get away with calling it battle damage. I would be curious if anybody else has built this kit and had the same issue. Let me know in the comments below. It's not too big an issue though, so I started building. The first step being to glue what will be a front plate onto that lower hull part. This is pretty simple, though of course the result isn't perfect. Before going too much further, some holes need to be drilled. There seem to be four guides for drilling in this roof part, but in this case the instructions say only to drill out the forward two, which is this pair that you can see I've drilled. Then I attach the driver's cabin, I guess is what you might call it. This fits neatly into place over the opening on the end of the upper hull part, guided by some helpful keying. And then, into the holes I drilled moments ago, this hatch part can be installed. It does look to be at a weird angle, but I guess that's how it's meant to be. Also, if you were to forget to drill the holes somehow, or you just didn't want to, you could still install this by clipping the guide pins off, and then eyeballing it into position. By which I don't mean using your eyeballs to nudge it into position, I mean using your eyes to determine the right position rather than guide pins. I probably don't really need to explain that, do I? I hope I don't. Next comes the rear plate, onto which I glue this thing. I don't think it's an exhaust, though it might be. After that, I install this shroud, which I did have a bit of trouble getting into a position that looked right. There's no keying for this, but eventually I glued it into a place I was satisfied with. And then, that assembly was glued onto the rear of the lower plate part. There is some keying to help you get this into position, and it should be pretty obvious if it's not attached properly. I then glue the upper hull section onto the top of the rear plate. This will eventually be glued at both ends, but I've left the front loose at this point to allow the join at the rear to bond properly. There seems to be enough tension in the plastic that one of the joins might come apart if you tried to glue both of them. Obviously, you could hold it while it bonds, but who has the time? We have hatches to install. There are two of these that go in the front of the driver's cab. I'm guessing there was more than one driver on these, or at least more than one man handling the steering, so two of these makes some sense, I suppose, though I don't really know for sure. I do know, however, that these parts go into place quite easily, and if you wanted, you could probably model them open without too much difficulty. Once those are in place, I glue the upper and lower hull together at the front. This does seem like an odd way to put the hull together, and at least one person in chat agreed, but I suppose, when looking at it, it does make sense. And it's not like it's difficult to put together. Next, it's time to assemble the track things. Well, I guess they're actually the entire side of the tank, really, aren't they? Whatever you might call them, they go together pretty easily. I started by gluing the ends of these together first. Then, when I'd got them together how they should be, I added more glue along the track runs to hold it all together good and proper. There's obviously one of these for either side, and then it makes sense to glue these to the central part of the hull. There is keying, and it was a bit tight, but a little bit of nudging and some pressure and the parts will go together. And here's me adding glue on the inside, which is needlessly fiddly. It's much easier to add glue along the outside of the joins. Eventually, we have something like this, which looks much more complete than it did a few moments ago, though clearly it still needs a few more things, like these little triangles. I am assuming, but I think these little holes are the exhausts, and these little triangle parts are some sort of deflector, or maybe just to keep the rain out. I'm no Mark 1 tank scientist, so I'm just guessing. Either way, the parts themselves aren't hard to get into place. They're not keyed, so you will have to do some eyeballing and nudging, but this isn't especially tricky. There were also some headlamps, but there was no mounting for them, and they proved to be annoying, so I omitted them. They're not visible in the pictures anyway. Next, it's time to build the gun turrets. Would you call these turrets? Gun emplacements? Whatever, these are pretty simple to assemble, and because this is a female tank, the guns are machine guns. There's not a whole lot of detail on these parts, but I don't think there really needs to be. Once all four are assembled, they can be placed inside the sponsons. The fit is pretty good, and they seem to stay in place with friction alone, which is nice if you want to be able to move them. The roof of the sponson comes next. This is the sponson for the tank's left, and the roof didn't fit very well, which could be entirely due to my own incompetence. The one for the right-hand side did fit much better, but I didn't film that one, did I? Oh well. I set the sponsons aside for the glue to bond while I worked on the racks, or whatever you would call these things that go on the roof. Do be careful here. I managed to break both of the rail parts, and it's not because I was rough. I was actually decidedly careful with the second one. They're simply fragile. They were easy enough to glue back together though. There are two standy pylon-y things for these, and with the guides molded in the bottom of the crossbeam thingies, they're very easy to put together. I put those aside and installed the sponsons, which was rather easy. They more or less just plop right into the big obvious openings for them on either side of the tank. I applied a little bit of pressure to minimize the gaps as much as I could, though the fit isn't totally perfect. Now, the tracks. I tried to neaten these up, but it's really hard to remove flash from this kind of rubbery material, and after a short while I stopped caring. You can see on the bottom of the track guide things, there are holes to accommodate the pins that join the tracks together, which I think is a nice touch. Initially, I wanted to glue the tracks together while partially on the tank, but it was a bit too fiddly, so I glued the tracks together, let them bond, and then stretched them onto the tank. Of course, I'm being careful to not allow the super glue bond holding the tracks together from coming apart. It's no secret that I don't enjoy rubber band tracks. I know some people like them, and that's okay, and these ones would be okay if it weren't for that awful flashing along the sides. I mean, the tracks on this kind of tank don't have a whole ton of detail, and no sag, so rubber band tracks do work for this kind of thing. It would just be nice if they were made a little bit better. I guess the way to hide that flash would be to cover the tracks in mud. The final step would be to add these roof rack thingies, and I would definitely suggest that you do these after installing the tracks like I've done. The instructions would say to do it before. You can see that these protrude over the tracks, and I'm confident that they would be broken when trying to install the tracks, and that would just be plain annoying. As it is, there are no guides for this part, and I guess that's because this isn't a standard part for every version this kit could make. It's not really an issue though, it's not hard to eyeball this using the instructions as a reference. That is kind of what they're there for. And with that, the Masterbox British Mark 1 Female with special modification for the Gaza Strip is now completed. I think for the most part this is a pretty good model. Obviously the tracks and their flash do take away from that quite a bit, but for the price I paid it's not too bad at all. And I will certainly have a look at some more Masterbox kits in the future, because why not? The plastic in the kit was pretty decent. Well, there was that one defect on the lower plate part, but these things do happen on occasion. It seems like a silly thing to get too upset about, and I'm pretty sure that's another thing that can easily be passed off as battle damage or simply covered in mud. These World War I tanks did get quite muddy. This kit was, for the most part, an enjoyable build. There was a bit of cleanup needed, of course, but nothing outrageous. And most of the parts did fit together pretty well, the notable exception being the sponson roof. Nothing a little bit of putty can't fix, though. Not only was it fun to build, it was relatively quick. And I got it done in one stream, which I guess isn't really an accurate measurement of time because the amount I get distracted can vary wildly, but it's a pretty good ballpark estimation. And I imagine that if I can get this done in 2 or 3 hours, with the distraction of streaming and videoing, the model could probably be built in a quarter of the time by a determined and non-distracted individual, though there's no real sense in rushing. Take your time and enjoy the process, and you'll probably find that you make fewer mistakes. Speaking of mistakes, I mean streaming, if you would like to watch me build kits like this live, as well as hang out with a pretty good bunch of chats folks, in addition to having the chance to win things, head on over to twitch.tv/herbert_erpaderp or follow the convenient link in the description. Okay, so I think this is a pretty decent model, particularly considering its price point, and it is an interesting subject. I don't often do World War I stuff, pretty much never really, but it's a nice change of pace from World War II. Also, the rivets on this kind of stuff can make painting really interesting and fun. I suppose it can also make it time consuming, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. Either way, I do have at least one other model from this era coming, and if you've been watching my streams you'll probably have a good idea of what it is, but if not, I guess you'll just have to stick around and find out. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them in the comment section below. Let me know if you're into World War I stuff. And if you are, and you've built some cool models, feel free to pop on over to our Discord community and share some pictures. That would be most excellent. If you've not done so already, why not subscribe, follow, ring the bell, become a patron or YouTube member, or just come say hi on Discord or Twitch. Links to all of my things are in the description, and as always, I shall return soon. So until then, be excellent to each other, and thanks for watching. Farewell.